Yeah, here's a lecture overview of all the topics we are going to cover today. So first, in this video, we will start with the brains and neuron models, just like a big picture overview. And then in the next video, we will talk about the perceptron learning rule, which is related to the Rosenblatt perceptron, which we briefly talked about in the last lecture. Then I will have a short interlude on vectorization in Python. That is just like a quick note of how we can make computational code in Python run more efficiently. So that is usually by replacing for loops with vector dot products, because that's something we are going to need in the next video when we talk about implementing a perceptron in Python using NumPy and PyTorch. Then optionally, I have a video planning to make a video on the perceptron convergence theorem. So I have to see how long these videos take, whether we have time for that, because to be honest, this is not like a super important topic. So, and I don't want to talk about it for too long and then not having enough time for other topics in this class, which I think are more relevant and more important. Here, the perceptron convergence theorem, that's a mathematical proof. It may be useful for some of you in other contexts, but to be honest, it's not really that useful for deep learning in the grand scheme. So if we cover it or not, it doesn't really matter for the rest of this course. So in this way, we have to really see how much time we have. And then lastly, I want to give a brief intuition into the geometric aspects of the perceptron, but one thing at a time. So let's start with brains and neural models. So like you recall from the history on deep learning, things were inspired by biological brains and how neurons work. So here's a picture of a neuron and then zooming in a little, of a brain and then zooming in a little bit. These are some neurons in the brain. I think this is actually from a mouse brain I took from Wikipedia. And here's a zoomed in version of a particular neuron. Here I think you can nicely see that neurons are connected to each other. Here in this neuron, this is a specific type of neuron. It's a pyramidal hippocampal neuron. So it's a neuron in the hippocampus, a pyramid neuron. And there are many different types of neurons in the brain. So this is only one type of neuron. And also the big question is usually, do our brains use deep learning at all? So in the human brain, is there some deep learning algorithm running? Actually, I don't think we can answer that with full certainty because people don't know yet how human brains work exactly. There are still many things that are not clear yet and many things that are still mysteries. However, I think we can confidently say though that it's probably not true because the brain is very complicated and deep learning, it performs well on certain tasks like object detection and so forth, but to be honest, the human brain and the capabilities of neural network are still very different. So because we don't have artificial general intelligence, I think that is like an indicator that maybe deep learning works differently. However, I recall there was also this paper by Geoff Hinton where they looked at the different learning algorithms. We briefly discussed that last lecture where they were the authors. It was not by Geoff Hinton. He was, I think, the last author on that. I think Lily Krepp was the first author. It doesn't really matter. So the gist was that the brain may use a type of algorithm that is somewhat related to backpropagation, but even that was not fully clear. So that still remains to be seen. But to be honest, also it doesn't really matter that much whether the human brain does deep learning or not, because deep learning, the things we have are actually pretty efficient for certain things that we or some people care about. For example, object detection. For object detection, classifying objects in an image, deep learning performs reasonably well, and it's kind of like similar to the analogy of the airplane and how birds work. So someone was inspired by how birds fly, or here in this case geese, and built the first airplanes. However, it wasn't that important to exactly mimic the bird, right? I mean, airplanes don't flap their wings, and I think also if you would design airplanes that have flapping wings, it wouldn't be more efficient than, let's say, airplane with flapping wings. So in that way, it's not always important to make something like exactly the same. Sometimes it's just useful to take something as an inspiration, and then you can develop things on top of it, but they don't have to be exactly the same to be useful. But yeah, just out of interest, I looked up on Wikipedia the number of neurons, because one might argue maybe neural networks are not as good as the human brain in terms of doing certain tasks, because the number of neurons is maybe different. When I look up the number here, it says 16,340,000,000 neurons in the human brain. So here in this case, we have 16 billion. If I look at the killer whale, it has 43 billion. So I would say human brain or humans are more intelligent than whales. Also, we can't answer that with 100% certainty, but that's my assumption here. So it can't be just the number of neurons that make something more intelligent. Also, if you think back of the large-scale language models that I introduced in the history of deep learning lecture, I think the big ones, they GPT-3 and stuff, you have to double check, but I think they had like 170-180 billion nodes in that, or parameters. So in that way, these models are actually even larger than the human brain in terms of the parameters, if you think of a parameter as a neuron. So in that way, these language models are even more powerful in terms of the computation than a human brain, or they are at least more parameters. And these models don't really perform as well as the human brain does. One thing they perform well at is like memorizing information. So these large-scale language models ingest lots of data from the internet, like lots of documents, and can kind of memorize them pretty well. And I think humans are not that good at memorizing things. But on the other hand, humans are better at understanding, which is something that these models lack. So it can't be just the number of parameters. There must be something different. But what it is, that has yet to be discovered. Yeah, so in this lecture, we are actually talking not about neural networks. We are talking about a single layer neural network or a biology. Yeah, and also in this lecture, we're not going to talk about multi-layer networks and networks with many, many, many parameters. We are going to start simple, talking about a neuron model. So a model of the biological neuron, like a computational model of the biological neuron. So just to recap what a biological neuron is. A neuron is a nerve cell. So here's, I circled one neuron where you have the cell core or nucleus. There are the dendrites where other neurons connect to, and there's the axon. The axon is where the signal gets transmitted. So usually the signal arrives at the dendrites, then it gets integrated or processed at the nucleus, and then it gets transmitted, if the neuron is activated, to nerve endings, and they are basically connecting to dendrites of other neurons. So here are so-called connections that are connecting two neurons. And whether this neuron provides a signal or not to the next neuron really depends on what happens in the processing core here, which is something we will talk about. Yeah, and the earliest neuron model, the earliest mathematical neuron model, was the McCulloch-Pitts model that we discussed in the history of deep learning. So just to briefly recap, so here's approximately how it would look like. So you have the inputs here. So the axes are your inputs. Let me draw this more clearly here. These are your inputs. And then you have certain weights here. So these are my weight parameters. And then this is our nucleus. That's where the signals get integrated. So it's a weighted sum. So you can also write it as, let's say in this case, if we have m inputs, then you can write it as follows, where you have each input multiplied with each weight. So this is the weighted input. And in deep learning, we usually call that the pre-activation. We use usually the mathematical letter Z. We also call it sometimes the net input. So that's more like a traditional term. So, and this value here is then passed onto a threshold function, and when the signal here reaches a certain threshold, then a corresponding signal gets transmitted. So the binary signal, binary means a 0 or 1 in this context. So 0 is transmitted if the value, the weighted sum, is below the threshold, and a 1 is transmitted if the 1 is above the threshold. But we will see that in more detail when we talk about the perceptron learning rule and the perceptron model. So here's an example of an AND gate that you can implement with this McCulloch's and Pitt neuron. This is just a recap also from the last lecture. So if you set these weights to 1, then our weighted sum is just x1 plus x2. And if the sum is bigger than 1.5, then it returns a 1 in this case, because 1 plus 1 is 2, right? So 1 plus 1 is 2, which is greater than the threshold, so you return a 1. And otherwise you return a 0, because if only one of the two is 1, then you won't reach the threshold of 1.5, and then the output is a 0. And this would be an AND gate. Similarly, you can also implement an OR gate. So here the threshold is smaller, so the weights are still 1, so you're computing x1 plus x2 and compare that value to the threshold. If both are 1, in this case the value is 2 and 2 is bigger than 0.5, so you return a 1. If one of the two is 1, then also your value is larger than the threshold, right? Because 1 plus 0 is 1, it's greater than 0.5, so you also return a 1 in both cases. Only if both are 0, then you return a 0, because 0 plus 0 is 0. So this is how you could use this concept of the McCulloch-Pitts model, for example, to implement different first-order logic functions. You can also implement a NOT gate, so I don't want to go into too much detail here, but you can walk through this maybe by yourself. And then another one as a take-home exercise: can you implement a logical XOR function using this McCulloch's Pitt neuron? So here is the table of a XOR function. Can you find weights here, and can you find a threshold such that this simple model here can implement the XOR gate as a ungraded homework exercise? You can maybe post on Piazza in a few days to see whether this is possible or not. All right, so this was just a brief introduction. Let's now talk about the perceptron model and the perceptron learning rules.